Welcome to DV Magazine's Basic Lighting for Digital Video. I'm John Jackman. On this program, we'll take a look at some good basic lighting gear. But more importantly, we're going to introduce you to the concepts of video lighting, the underlying principles that you can use in any situation. Good lighting, like good audio, is often the forgotten stepchild of video production. Even pros will take risky shortcuts or shoot in iffy existing light, and this undermines the quality of the finished product. Spending extra time and thought on your lighting before and during shooting may make the difference between an average shot and a truly great one. I receive letters all the time asking my advice on equipment purchases. In one way or another, many of these letters actually have to do with lighting issues. Here's a letter that I received from a large church. "One of the problems I encounter on a regular basis is that the stage lighting is very uneven, and my cameras are always on manual exposure and have to dial up and down as they pan from one side of the stage to the other, which is very annoying. Do we need better cameras, or can we make do with the right lighting techniques? With the right lighting, you'll do much better than just make do. With good lighting, an average camera can turn out a pretty stunning picture, but bad lighting can challenge the capabilities of even the most expensive camera." Every scene is different. Each situation is filled with new challenges. Part of the fun of professional lighting is figuring out just the right approach for every unique situation, kind of like a lighting detective.
The streets were dark in this gloomy town. It was pretty dark in here, too. The existing light left the shot too contrasty. It was the case of the missing light kit. Everything was pretty gloomy until, suddenly, someone turned on the lights. It was still dark outside, but in here, the addition of a simple light kit and a little know-how meant that the case was closed.
Verily, without proper lighting, video can be stale, flat, and unprofitable. Hark what light from yonder window breaks, illuminating my face for wondrous fair video.
Well, you get the idea. Lighting can make or break a scene, and it's up to you, the videographer, to light the scene well. The term for a lighting electrician in the video and film world is gaffer, and the gaffer's assistant is known as a best boy, even when that person's a female. But unless you're on a big union shoot with a huge budget, you're going to have to serve as camera operator, gaffer, best boy, and maybe even a grip or two, all rolled into one. By the time you finish this tape, we'll have given you a crash course in gaffer gimmicks and best boy basics. But the first thing we need to do is review how the video signal is measured and go over some basic terminology. The video signal is measured on two variations of the oscilloscope. These are classic workhorse examples from a broadcast facility. The first is a waveform monitor, which measures the changing voltage of the signal, determined by the amount of light hitting the camera imaging chips. The legal signal for NTSC video is divided into 100 units. Now, this whole system was set up a long time ago by the old Institute of Radio Engineers, so these were known as IRE units, or just IRE. Now, that venerable institution has long since changed its name to the Institute of Electronics Engineers, or IEE, but everybody still refers to them by the old name, IRE, and we will too through this program. Legal video varies between a black level of 7.5 IRE, often referred to as pedestal or setup, to 100 IRE. Most broadcasters will allow what are called limited excursions above 100 for a point of light or a bright reflection, but it's best not to exceed the legal limit. The other significant part of the video signal is the color or chroma content, and that's measured down here on the vectorscope. This displays the color content and saturation of the video signal by tracing a path or vector in different directions on the screen. If your camera is correctly adjusted by a technician and you've properly white balanced to the light source you'll be using, things will be fine in Vectorville. So we won't be talking much about vectorscope levels in this basic lighting tape, but we will be talking about it more in our next tape, Advanced Lighting for Digital Video. But the levels displayed on the waveform monitor are directly related to lighting and exposure, the two topics we're covering in this program. I mentioned that most folks still use the obsolete term for waveform measurement. That's not unusual. You'll hear a lot of jargon that's not by the book. The video and film trade is just chock full of odd terminology, and you'll find that some terms vary region by region, others are used interchangeably, and some are just misused. As we go through, we're going to try to share with you the common terms that are used for most items, not just the dictionary definition. But before we get into some specific lighting setups, it's a good idea to understand the basic principles behind good lighting. I know everybody likes to jump right into the nifty technology, but a solid understanding of the basics will serve you far better than expensive hardware. If you understand the critical issues, you can improvise great lighting in almost any situation, often with items right at hand. So let's take a look at the bedrock issues of controlling contrast and color. The most important issue for all video lighting is an understanding of how differently the camera works from your eye in perceiving light. Now, the eye is an amazing optical device created to work in all kinds of lighting situations. The contrast handling of the eye is truly astounding, with an ability to discern detail in a dynamic range that can sometimes approach 800 to 1. This means that even in very contrasty lighting situations, your eye can see detail in both brightly lit areas and dimly lit areas at the same time. This isn't true for either film or video. Film has a much more restricted dynamic range than the eye. Even the most sensitive film can only achieve a contrast handling of a little more than 120 to 1. That means that above this range, the film will only record pure white with no detail, and below this range, the film will only record black, again with no detail. So in a film scene, every area where we wish to perceive detail has to be lit above this minimum level, but not exceed this maximum level. Video has an even more restricted dynamic range. Although this has improved a lot in recent years, even the best cameras can only handle a contrast ratio of about 30 to 1. This ratio decreases even more once you go into post-production a couple of generations. Once again, this means that outside the dynamic range that the camera can perceive, there will be no detail, only clipped white or solid black. This is particularly true in digital formats, which allow only 10% over the legal limit before the signal maxes out to a solid white. With analog formats like Beta-SP, over-limit signals often still contain detail, and in post you can scale the signal down to a legal level with a device called a proc amp, and still find detail in the hot areas of the picture. With digital formats, though, like DV, DVCam, DVC Pro, Digital S, and Digital Betacam, above 110 IRE, it's just white, period. There's no detail there to retrieve. You can see the problem, which is called clipped whites, very well in this picture. Unless you're Ansel Adams, you've probably brought home some still shots like this one from your vacations. And this is a perfect illustration because to the photographer's eye, the scene probably looked okay. But the difference in light levels between the foreground and the background, the contrast ratio, simply exceeded the ability of the 35mm still film to capture. The solution, of course, is to add light to the foreground to reduce the contrast ratio. The greater contrast handling of film over video is one of the reasons many producers still prefer to shoot on film, particularly outdoors, where it's more difficult to control lighting. This difference in contrast handling is precisely where the problem occurs. Your eye is quite comfortable at a contrast level way beyond the ability of your camera to record. So a scene that looks fine to your eye may record as contrasty or overexposed, with no detail in critical areas. The real trick of video lighting is controlling contrast and designing lighting for the compressed dynamic range of the camera. This means that you must control strong highlights and reflections and throw some fill into dark shadowed areas. Another central issue for video lighting is that of light color, referred to as color temperature. This is the human eye puts video cameras to shame. Not only does the eye perceive a wider latitude of light levels, the combination of the eye and the brain can compensate for a number of different color temperatures. Now, we can't show on video what your eye actually sees, so we've created an approximation here on videotape of the way your eye perceives different color temperatures in the same scene. You can look into a room lit by a fluorescent tube at one end, an incandescent bulb at the other, with sunlight streaming in the window, and not really have the mixture of light sources bother you. If you're really observant, you may notice the slight differences in the color of the sources, though it won't seem extreme to your eye. But the different color temperatures of the light sources are grotesquely obvious to the camera, which can only balance to one color temperature at a time. Either the sunlight will seem intensely blue, the incandescent light orange, or the fluorescent light green. It's essential for you to correct color differences between lighting sources in your shoot, and then to white balance your camera to the temperature of the main source. Most cameras have an auto white balance, or auto tracing white, which will attempt to set the camera to the prevailing light source automatically. This can work fine, or it can create problems when shooting in mixed color temperatures. The more reliable method is to perform a manual white balance to the primary light source. All you're doing is telling the camera which color temperature in the scene you want reproduced as white. Aim the camera at a white card illuminated by that light source and press the white balance button. This sets the camera precisely to the proper color temperature range. Sunlight is generally measured at 5600K in the blue range, while typical quartz video lights measure at 3200K in the yellow range. Basic to your lighting kit will be gels and correction filters to convert between the two lighting temperatures. Fluorescent lighting can range from 4800K for daylight bulbs to 3600K for warm bulbs. Common fluorescent lighting has a strong and spiky green component, which many find objectionable. But again, special gel colors are available to convert fluorescent lighting to match either daylight or quartz so that all your light sources match. If you take care of these two basic issues, controlling contrast and color balance, you will be well on your way to lighting. We're going to take a look at a whole range of basic lighting instruments to see which ones best fit your needs. A very common general purpose light is the Lowell Tota light. It's basically a simple quartz tube with a collapsible V-shaped reflector. It's inexpensive, packs small, and lights large areas well. It can take bulbs from 500 to 1,000 watts. But it can't be focused, so it's really not the best for careful controlled lighting. On the other hand, it does have an umbrella stand, and so it can be used to create an inexpensive soft light source. Another somewhat more flexible instrument from Lowell is the OmniLight, which is a focusing instrument. It accepts bulbs ranging from 400 to 650 watts AC and can run a 100 watt bulb off of 12 volts DC. The bulb can be focused to vary between a narrow, hard-edged light or a softer, wide flood beam. OmniLights can be had with all sorts of accessories, from various types of reflectors, to screens, to barn doors for controlling the spread of the light. These also have an umbrella bracket, so they can be used as a soft light source. Now, the standard workhorse of theatrical and video lighting is the Fresnel. These are named for the unique stepped lens that they use. These lenses, which are relatively flat, with a series of stepped focusing rings molded into the glass, are very light and economical for their strong focusing power. Now this instrument happens to be made by Airy, but Fresnels are available from a wide range of manufacturers. The Airy Fresnels are tough and designed specifically for location use. They can be focused to a very tight spotlight or used as a broad soft flood. They're available in a variety of sizes and can take a wide range of bulb wattages. The wide focus ability and the various sizes are why they're used in so many different situations. This one has a common accessory you'll use on many lights, barn doors. These are hinged flaps which are used to control the spread of light, usually mounted on a frame which slips into a holder on the front of the light. The origin of this name is fairly obvious. Barn doors come in various shapes and sizes, some with two doors, others with four doors. The holder in the front of the Fresnel can also receive metal frames which hold colored gels. But it's common for gaffers to simply use C47s to clip an uncut piece of gel directly to the barn doors, like this. So what's a C47? Hold on, let me rummage in my gaffer's survival kit, and I'll show you one. As we rummage through this kit during the rest of the program, we'll be building up a list of essential items that you really must have along with you on a shoot. I'll sum up the list at the end of the show. C47s are highly specialized general purpose clamps developed specifically for the lighting trade. You probably won't be able to find these expensive items anywhere but at a sophisticated lighting supply service. Or then again, maybe not. C47s are just spring wooden clothespins, the kind your mom used to use on the laundry. Make sure you buy the wooden ones, not the plastic. The plastic will melt. But you'll never see a professional gaffer on a set without a whole bunch of these. But watch out for those seasoned pros. Some of them like to play tricks. They'll see how many C47s they can clip on the back of the new kit before he or she notices. Hi, Blake. Keep up the good work. Whatever you call them or wherever you wear them, they're just clothespins, but they're also indispensable, so make sure you don't run short. Equally handy are a set of all-purpose clamps like these. You can get them at any hardware store. Get a variety of sizes. You'll find never-ending use for these as gaffer gimmicks. And speaking of gaffer gimmicks, here's one you don't want to be without: gaffer's tape. While this looks very much like a high grade of duct tape, it's not. It's formulated with a special adhesive that won't peel paint off walls and won't melt in the hot lights. Gaffer's tape is available in white, gray, or black for different applications. I think the most commonly used color is black because it reduces reflections. It's always best to have a full roll of this in your kit. Once you've used it, you won't ever want to be without it.
The Fresnel lens was invented in 1822 by French physicist Augustin Fresnel for use in lighthouses. Because of its high power and light weight, it rapidly became the most commonly used lens in the lighting industry.
Over the last several years, soft lighting has become very popular in film and video. Now, the original soft light was an umbrella reflector like this, as we used on Lowell lights earlier. But umbrellas are very inefficient. They lose a lot of the light that you put into them, hence the development of the softbox. This is a frame and reflector that allows you to place a large piece of diffusion fabric in front of a bulb, usually in a standard instrument. This one's a chimera mounted on an Airy light. Chimeras are very popular in the industry. They're available to fit a wide range of standard lighting instruments. Lowell makes this one, known as the Rifa light. This is an all-in-one unit that folds up sort of like an umbrella. And Photoflex makes this interesting combination here, known as the Silver Dome. The front part is a basic softbox, except the interior is colored silver instead of white, and it uses a special bulb and holder called a starlight. This bulb is supposed to project light to the reflective sides of the cone rather than directly forward. Any of these soft lights will serve the average videographer pretty well. They're all well-made, easily transportable methods of holding a large piece of diffusion to soften the light. Let's go back to our gaffer's survival kit now to take a look at some general-purpose diffusion material that you can use to soften any light source.
The softbox An umbrella-style device for mounting a diffusion screen directly onto a lighting instrument was originally known as a chronicone, after its inventor, cinematographer Jordan Cronenweth.
In addition to a good assortment of colored gels, you'll also need to have a variety of diffusion materials. These are available from the gel manufacturers Roscoe and Lee, and also from some other smaller manufacturers such as CCM. This fiber-based material is known as tough spun, while this frosted plastic sheet material is known as tough frost. Diffusion materials are available in a wide variety of grades, depending on how much they soften the light. You use these sheets just like gels in front of the light source. In emergencies, any white translucent material can be used to diffuse a light source. It's a good idea to pack an old white sheet in your gaffer's survival kit for those emergencies. It's an even better idea to go down to your local fabric store and ask them for several yards of organza. That's the fabric they make wedding veils out of. Get some white and get some black as well. The white can be used for diffusion in all sorts of circumstances, although you should avoid getting it too close to the bulb because it may burn. The black can be used as a sort of neutral density filter to cut down on the level of light, or as a makeshift scrim. Scrims are odd-shaped metal frames which are covered with screening material, organza, or silk. They're used to cut down the light level to a specific part of the set that's too brightly lit. We'll show you how to use a scrim in an actual situation later in the program. If you're the least bit handy, you can make them yourself out of wire and organza, or you can buy them ready-made from a lighting supplier. Now let's look at a different category of lighting instrument. An important accessory which will serve you well in many circumstances is a small on-camera light. Now there are a lot of these available from different manufacturers, so shop around, but spend enough money to get a good one. This NRG Verilux has a built-in dimmer which can be used to control the light level. An on-camera light can provide just enough fill to make the difference between a shot which just doesn't work and one which looks good. An on-camera light can also be used as an eye light, as it's known in the trade. This is a tiny, low-powered light which is positioned especially to cast a little reflection in the eye of the subject. This adds some liveliness to the subject's eye that just isn't there if that glint is absent. I'll put my glasses back on now so I can see what I'm doing. Chimera, the manufacturer of one of the soft boxes we looked at a minute ago, even makes a teeny tiny one for on-camera lights. This is called the Micro Light Bank. This can work really well in some situations where it provides a subtle and even fill that doesn't look quite so much like an in-your-face news shot. I'm often asked if it's possible to use the cheap work lights available at home improvement centers for video. The answer is sure you can. They don't work quite as well, and they're certainly not as controllable as lights made for the purpose, but they will serve you until you can afford something better. The main problem to watch out for is the variation in color temperatures from the inexpensive quartz bulbs that different manufacturers use. These can range anywhere from 2600 degrees Kelvin to 3000 degrees Kelvin, usually falling a bit to the orange side of the standard 3200K quartz lights. Make sure you buy the same brand of bulb for all the work lights and perform a manual white balance on the camera before you shoot. But used creatively, these lights can make good video. If you're handy with tools, you can even mount a bracket like this one to hold an umbrella as an inexpensive soft light source. Another good option is to get standard photo floods from a photographic supply house, or you could look around for used theatrical Fresnels like this one. They're built a little differently from professional video lights, but they throw off the same kind of light and provide a high level of control. After you've made some money, spend a little of it on some professional lights. They're designed for the purpose, they're easier to handle, and they'll prove more flexible in a variety of situations. We'll cover more of the professional lighting options, such as fluorescent banks and HMIs, in our next program. Here are a few tips on using professional video lights. The first, most important rule you must not break is to never touch a quartz lamp with your skin. Now, no sensible person is going to touch one while it's hot, but this rule applies while they're cold as well. Especially when installing bulbs, always use a clean tissue, piece of paper towel, or similar material to actually hold the lamp with. Professional gaffers will carry around white cotton gloves, especially for this purpose. The reason is a tiny smudge of oil from your skin will concentrate the heat and cause a quartz lamp to explode. Another type of glove that gaffers always have with them are a pair of heat-resistant gloves for adjusting hot lights. These things throw off a lot of heat. You don't want to touch one carelessly after it's been on a while. Because of the heat, you also need to be careful to keep these away from flammable materials like drapery. It's easy to start a fire with a 1,000-watt Fresnel. Be cautious about moving the light while it's on. A sudden jolt while the filament is powered can cause it to burn out. Now let's take a look at a basic lighting setup in an actual studio. Hi, Danielle. How are you?
Fine.
Good. Here you see the effect of typical overhead room lighting. It's not very friendly for video. It does light up the room, but it also casts harsh shadows from the eyebrows and the nose, and the look is just unappealing. Good video lighting rarely comes from above, but shines more directly into the face from a slightly elevated position, like these lights here. The most common configuration used in video is the three-point lighting setup. We're going to see what this looks like on Danielle in just a moment, but first let's dissect the setup to see how it works in 3D. The subject is placed in front of a background, in this case at a slight angle to the camera. Three lights are used. The first principal light is known as the key light. This is generally placed a bit above and a little off axis from the subject's face to provide some modeling effect and definition. This provides the main illumination for the scene, but by itself is too contrasty. The second light, known as the backlight, or sometimes the halo light, is placed directly behind the subject or off axis a little to keep it out of frame. The backlight is usually positioned at the same height or a little higher than the key light. The addition of the backlight provides definition and modeling and helps to visually separate the subject from the background. But the picture is still too contrasty. Fill light is needed to illuminate the detail in the shadows. The fill light is usually about half the power or intensity of the other two lights. It's placed about 90 degrees from the key light to fill in the shadowed areas with a lower intensity light. The height is generally about the same as the key. Now we can see that the three lights used in this manner provide visual modeling and definition, but also a limited range of contrast which allows us to see detail in the highlights as well as the shadows. You may have noticed that the background was not illuminated in our illustration. Often you can use spill or existing light for the background, but I advocate lighting the background separately for greater control. Of course, this turns our classic three-light setup into a four-light setup, but no one's going to complain if your video looks really great. In this case, we've used a virtual Fresnel with barn doors to provide a simple angled slash of light across the backdrop. This creates a professional look with full control of both the background and the model. Now let's create the same look in reality. We're going to use three Fresnels, two 650-watt and one 300-watt. The typical rule for a three-point lighting setup is to use key and backlights of the same wattage and then use a fill light that's about half the intensity of the other two. First, turn on the key light. Position it so that it models the face well. Modeling refers to the highlights and shadows that create a sense of depth and three dimensions to the scene. The height of the key light makes a lot of difference, so experiment with it a little bit to get the look that you want. If you're lighting the background separately, as we're going to do, focus it so that it does not illuminate the visible portion of the backdrop. You may need to use barn doors or a flag to control the spread of the light. Then we'll add the backlight. Now that we've lit Danielle with the key, separated her from the background with the backlight, let's add the fill light to finish the foreground illumination. Remember, it's common to use the fill light to illuminate the background, but we're not doing that here. Let's take a look at each of the lights individually. The key light provides the main illumination and modeling with highlight and shadow. The fill light illuminates the areas left in shadow by the key, thus reducing the contrast of the image. The backlight helps to separate the subject from the background. This three-point lighting setup will work for most situations, but don't just work from a formula. Experiment a little bit to get different looks based on the same principle. Try moving the fill light out a little bit to decrease the intensity. What this will do is increase the contrast of the scene and maybe give you a little of the film noir look. Or you may wish to move the other lights off axis a bit to achieve stronger modeling. Experiment with the height of both the key and the fill. We used a fill of half the intensity of the key. This is technically known as a low-key setup, where the key light is strong and focused on the subject, while the remainder of the picture is lit at a much lower level. The key to fill ratio is 2:1. The ratio may be even wider, 3:1 or even 4:1, which results in a more dramatic and contrasty picture with very strong shadows. Note that even with a more shadowy look, you should still try to work inside the contrast range of the camera, which we discussed earlier, and have fill levels which will provide some detail in the shadowed areas of the face. In our next program, Advanced Lighting for DV, we'll look at how to adapt this basic three-point setup for specialized situations such as blue screen shots or extremely critical close-ups. At this point, you may see some gaffers taking light levels with a meter like this one, although that's more common in film and more advanced productions. You can set the iris on your camera very scientifically using a waveform monitor, as I mentioned earlier in the program. Let's go over here and see what this looks like on the waveform monitor. Facial highlights are coming in at 80 IRE with the shadowed areas about half that. And the background, which is hardly illuminated at all, is hitting 15 IRE, which is just right. Let's go move the lights around, see if we can get a different look. In this traditional setup, Danielle's face is angled slightly, and the key light illuminates the side of her face that's toward the camera. One variation that's very common and quite effective is to reverse the positions of the key and fill lights to create what's called an offside key. Let's kill the lights. In this variation, the key light illuminates the side of the face away from the camera. It gives a more dramatic feel to the shot. If you want to vary the intensity of the light, the best method is to move the light closer to or further away from the subject. You can use a dimmer, of course, but remember that the dimmer may change the color temperature of the lights. As the level gets lower, it will also get more orange. Move the key out a bit. Moving the lights simply changes the intensity without changing the color temperature at all. The rule of thumb for lighting and distance is that if you move the light twice as far away from the subject, it will cut the light level down to 1/4 the original intensity. And the reverse is also true. If you halve the distance to the subject, it will increase the light level by a factor of 4. Take a look at how this works. Halving the distance from the light to the subject quadruples the intensity. While the opposite is also true, moving the light twice as far away from the subject results in about 1/4 the original intensity. Bring the fill back in, please. Now that we're happy with our three-point lighting setup, let's light the background. First thing we're going to try is to cast a slash of light across the backdrop the same way we did in our 3D rendering, using a Fresnel with the barn doors almost completely closed. That looks nice, but let's experiment. This cutout pattern is called a cookie. You can buy them pre-made, or you can make them yourself out of plywood or foam core. This one will cast slashes of light across the background, but I think I'm going to use this one, which has a paisley pattern. The name is short for Cucoloris, though hardly anyone uses that original term anymore. You'll also hear these called gobos, and there can be quite an argument between the gobo crowd and the cookie crowd as to which is which. But in traditional film reference, a gobo is a large freestanding black flat which is used to control light spread, or a stand-mounted flag like this one. We'll talk about using flags later in the program. They can be used to cast a shadow on a set or to protect from a lens flare. A cookie, on the other hand, is used to cast a pattern of light and shadow. We're going to mount the cookie in front of our background light on the adjustable gobo arm of a C-stand. Once the cookie's in position, we're going to go over here and open the barn doors on the Fresnel and turn it on and focus it so that we're casting a pattern of light and shadow all the way across the backdrop behind the model. Let's add a little color by putting a lavender gel on the background light that's shining through the cookie. Since we've already deviated from a strict three-point lighting setup, let's add a fifth light now. This one, a lower wattage fill with a different colored gel on it. The purpose of this is to fill in the dark areas of the cookie pattern and add a little more pleasing subtlety to it. That gives us an interesting look with plenty of contrast and texture, but the background isn't so busy that it distracts the eye from the focal point of the picture, which is Danielle. As I mentioned before, this is a low-key setup where the key-to-fill ratio is high, and the background is illuminated at a much lower level than the foreground subject. The opposite, a high-key setup, uses a low key-to-fill ratio, which has a much smaller difference between the highlights and shadows. These terms are a little counterintuitive. They sound like the opposite of their actual meaning, so they're often misused. In a high-key setup, a very wide dispersion key light will be used to illuminate the entire set equally. The fill might be of equal or nearly equal wattage to the key, but bounced or positioned further away. Because the difference between background and foreground is less pronounced, the backlight becomes even more important to provide definition between the subject and the background. The high key setup is usually used in large studios where a lot of people have to move around and still be well lit, like a soap opera or a news set, but it's not used so much in other situations because it has a flat look. Earlier I mentioned that you can use a waveform monitor or a light meter when setting the light levels and setting the camera aperture. But actually the most common way to set camera exposure is inside the camera itself, the zebra display. This is a feature on professional cameras and some prosumer cameras, which displays a striped pattern in the viewfinder on highlight areas of the picture. Now there are two types of zebra displays, 100 IRE and 70 to 90 IRE. They're used differently, so it's important to know which type you're looking at. Professional cameras usually have both types, selectable from a setup menu. 70 to 90 IRE zebra is most useful in interview settings to properly expose facial highlights. The zebra pattern appears on highlights between 70 IRE and 90 IRE and vanishes above 90 IRE. In some cameras, the exact range is adjustable. Since properly exposed Caucasian skin highlights should fall at about 80 IRE, the camera operator adjusts the iris to display a zebra pattern on the highlighted areas of the subject's face. The second type displays a zebra pattern only on areas of the picture which exceed 100 IRE, the upper limit of legal video. With this type of zebra, the camera operator adjusts the iris until the zebra is visible in highlight areas, then backs off just a little bit until the pattern just vanishes, so you don't overexpose the scene. This type of pattern is more useful for general purpose exposure and exteriors, but less accurate for setting close-ups on faces. Now that we have the camera exposure properly set, let's play with the lights a little. These Fresnels are fairly hard lights, which means that they cast a sharp-edged shadow. Let's see what would happen if we brought a softbox into this setup. Nice work, Blake. There are two main ways to convert a three-point lighting setup to a soft look. The most obvious one is to replace the hard-edged key light with a softbox. But remember that the diffusion on the front of the softbox is very inefficient, so you might have to replace that 650-watt Fresnel with a 1,000-watt softbox. But the look is really quite nice, much softer and richer in feel than the look created by hard lights. The other way to create a soft look is to have a diffused fill light. Here, rather than using a softbox, we're going to use a 650-watt Omnilight with an umbrella. You'll remember that this is an even more inefficient diffusion method than the softbox, cutting the actual light output of the instrument by more than half. But this is also a nice look, a little more subtle softness than using the soft key light. You can get a slightly different soft fill by bouncing the fill light off a white ceiling, or off a white reflector or foam core board held by a C-stand or assistant. Some shooters even use multiple soft boxes to achieve an extremely soft, portrait-like effect for their interviews. As you can see, this creates a very soft effect, much like a still portrait photographer might use.
Although most academic works on film and theater history trace the origin of the term koukalouros back to the Greek word for breaking or shattering light, Greek scholars inform us that it isn't a Greek word at all, so the origin of this odd term remains obscure.
You'll have to try these various approaches to find the look that you like best. Don't be afraid to experiment. Just remember all the time that what you're doing is trying to control contrast to keep the camera happy, not your own eyes. And the best way to do that is to actually look at the picture through the camera. That brings us to the next item in our Gaffer's Survival Kit, the portable field monitor. One of the most important accessories you can take into the field is a portable field monitor. This allows you to see the scene the way the camera sees it. Now, these are usually pretty expensive, so if you're on a tight budget, you might buy one of the better LCD units that are on the market, or a battery-powered portable television that has AV inputs. Neither will be as good as a true professional field monitor, but they may be good enough to prevent you from making a disastrous mistake in the field. It's critical to have your monitor adjusted properly. The color test pattern designed by the Society of Motion Picture and Television Engineers, or SMPTE, helps you to do this. Make sure the monitor is warmed up and the signal is properly terminated. Notice the grayscale rectangle in the lower right-hand side of the screen. This is known as the plouge. It has three bars, one 0 IRE, or super black, one 7.5 IRE, or black, and one at 15 IRE, which is a dark gray. Adjust the brightness and contrast controls until you can just barely see the difference between the black and dark gray bars, but the difference between the super black and black is no longer visible. Now turn off the red and green guns so that you can only see blue. Most pro monitors have a blue-only switch. If yours doesn't, you can also look at the monitor through a Rattan 47B filter, available at any photo supply store. Notice the color bars, which each have a contrasting block at the bottom. With the blue gun only on, while watching the third and fifth bars, adjust the hue until the top and bottom portions appear to match. Now, watching the first and seventh bars, adjust the chroma control until the top and bottom portions match. Turn on the red and green guns again and double-check the plouge. Since all these controls interact somewhat with each other, you may have to go back and fine-tune them again. Now your monitor is properly set up.
The grayscale chips in the SMPTE color pattern, which are used to adjust the contrast and brightness of a monitor, are known as the plouge. The name originated at the BBC as an acronym for Picture Lineup Generation Equipment.
Make sure your monitor is battery-powered for those outdoor shoots, because you'll need it. Hey, Slim.
Howdy.
Outdoors, you have a whole new set of lighting problems to contend with, because the light source you're using is much harder to control. Whenever possible, conduct your outdoor shoots on a slightly overcast day like this, when there's natural diffusion for that intense light source 93 million miles away. On an extremely overcast day, you may even need to add some artificial light to punch up the contrast a bit. But you can't always control your shooting schedule, and you certainly can't control the weather. So the odds are, eventually, you're going to be unfortunate enough to be shooting outdoors on a beautiful sunny day like this one. So what's wrong with great weather? Contrast, the main issue we've been talking about all along. Undiffused sunlight like this creates strong highlights and contrasty shadows, usually exceeding the camera's dynamic range.
And it makes you squint, too.
So you're either going to have to do something to cut down on the intensity of the key, the sun, or to fill in the shadows. You could drag a generator and a 20,000 watt HMI light out here as a fill, but the problem is you've got too much light already. So a better solution is to simply rearrange the existing light that you already have with a simple, no power device, a reflector. Now this happens to be a Photoflex light disc, but similar folding reflectors are available from a number of different manufacturers. They pack small and fold out large, and are available in white, silver, or gold. Each color gives you a slightly different look to your shot. By simply standing out of frame and using the reflected sunlight, I can create enough fill to illuminate the shadowed areas and reduce the contrast of the picture to an acceptable range. Of course, you don't have to buy one of these collapsible reflectors. In a pinch, any white or silver board will do. In fact, a very common substitute is a piece of white foam core, which you can buy inexpensively at any office supply store. Another somewhat more cumbersome method is to actually introduce a large piece of diffusion material between the sun and the subject. What this does is to knock the highlights down a little bit and introduce some diffused light into the shadows. This is a relatively small diffusion frame made with that simple white organza that we have out of our Gaffer's Survival Kit. As you can see, this improves the situation a lot, though often you'll still need a reflector to supply fill to the shadowed areas. This balances out the picture perfectly. Another issue to keep in mind is the ugliness of direct overhead lighting that I mentioned earlier. In most areas of the country, it's a good idea to avoid shooting during the middle of the day on a bright sunny day like this, say from 11 to 2 when the sun is at its zenith. The low angles of early morning or late afternoon are best. In fact, professional filmmakers refer to the hour before sunset as the golden hour, and they'll go to great lengths to shoot at that time. And here you see why. An hour before sunset, the light is very flattering and takes on a rich golden hue that really enhances the colors in any shot. Though inconvenient, waiting for the golden hour is really worth it for an important shoot. Just make sure you're completely set up and prepared in advance. That golden light is fleeting, and you won't have a full hour to tape in. Let's go look at a few other classic lighting problems. Remember our goofy examples at the beginning of the show? This evening exterior was shot without any additional lighting, and it's a horrible example of what happens when you simply don't have enough light to shoot. The camera iris is cranked full open, the gain is up, creating a flat, grainy picture. And this really doesn't look like night at all, it just looks like bad video. Let's take a peek at how we fixed it. Only two 650 watt Fresnels were used. One gelled dark blue, positioned as a backlight, and the other gelled a warm straw color and positioned high and to the front. The blue backlight exploits the Hollywood vernacular of using blue to represent moonlight. It suggests night while also providing some lighting definition. Not as literally realistic as black inky shadows, but instantly accepted as nighttime. The second light simulates light coming from a second story window. These lights allow the camera operator to turn off the gain and close the iris slightly. The result is clean video exposure that really gives the impression of nighttime. In our next program, we'll explore more of the subtleties of lighting night shoots and other cinematic situations. Oh, and remember the poorly lit private eye? This one is a classic illustration of excessive contrast. Not enough light in most of the frame combined with a bright light source, which makes it impossible to expose the dim areas properly. Incidentally, when an actual light source such as this appears in the frame, it's known as a practical. Practicals can be very tricky. They add their own light, but usually not enough to light the scene properly. The scene lights must be very carefully balanced with practicals to get the proper effect. Let's take a look at the fix. First, a soft focus key is used to illuminate the detective's face. The beam is controlled with barn doors and a flag so that it only illuminates the face inside. This simulates the illumination from the practical, but doesn't throw extra shadows which might give the fake away. Then the 100-watt bulb in the desk lamp is changed out for a 40-watt bulb, reducing the contrast the practical creates. Finally, a low-wattage fill, in this case a 150-watt photo flood, is bounced off a white card to create a dim, diffused fill light. The result is well-exposed video, with detail and texture in every part of the frame. Now let's take a look at a very similar problem which you'll run into with some regularity. Here's a common problem. Sunlight streaming in a window, upsetting the contrast and color balance of an otherwise well-composed picture. Just like our detective shot, an excessive light source in frame makes the contrast ratio too high to properly expose
the sunlight as a blue-tinted backlight.
Make sure you white balance to the quartz lights instead of the sunlight, and you'll get a very nice picture by cheating with two different color temperatures of light. Now, I sometimes like the effect of mixed color temperatures when they're well controlled, but not everybody does. The textbook solution is to use a blue gel over the quartz light to balance it to the temperature of sunlight. This gives a balanced color temperature to both the key and backlight from the window. If you simply must have the window in frame, you're either going to have to load up a lot of daylight balanced lights into the room or do something to reduce the level of light coming in the window. One of the ways you can do that is with the black organza from our Gaffer's Survival Kit. You can tack this either on the inside or outside of the window, and it will knock a couple stops off the light that's coming in. You can also use the large sheets of neutral density gel, which are made just for this purpose. In a pinch, you can even use the window tint that's sold in automotive supply shops. What all these do is to reduce the light coming in the window so that it's easier to light the interior and preserve the proper contrast range. This shot can work well when properly set up, but this is really one you want to check with the field monitor to make sure that what you're doing works. Hiya, man, how are you?
I'm good, thanks.
Good. Another common problem is lighting people of color, or even more complex, lighting people of color on the same set as light-skinned people. Just as with everything else we've been talking about in this program, a central issue is contrast. Your problems will be greater if the dark-skinned model wears very light clothing or appears against a very light background. Take pains to warn subjects to wear medium contrast clothes and to make sure that the background is not white or near white when shooting subjects that have darker complexions. This is really true even when the subject doesn't have dark skin. Avoid pure white whenever possible. In the old days of the Vidicon tube camera, pure white was forbidden on any set. News anchors wore light blue or gray shirts, and their notes were typed on a special gray paper. This is still true in the film world, where prop masters will soak white shirts in strong tea to knock a bit of the brightness off. Cameras have improved a lot, but it's still a good idea to avoid pure white whenever possible. It will make your lighting job easier all the time, but especially with darker skin tones. Obviously, dark skin is going to require more light to create a proper contrast range. Now, a man here actually has a fairly medium skin tone that's easy to light by just moving the key light in a little bit. But when lighting extremely dark complexions, sometimes it seems almost impossible to create enough highlights to model the face. In those circumstances, you can create highlights with reflections off the skin. This is done with a kicker light, which is similar to a backlight, except located a few degrees off to one side. Just when you've solved one lighting problem, another one crops up. It's very common to have to light a set for both light-skinned and dark-skinned subjects at the same time. But if you set the lights for the darker-skinned subject, then often the light-skinned subject will look washed out like you see here. But by the same token, if you set the lights for the light-skinned subject, often the darker subject will not have enough definition. And we want everyone to look their best. The best way to fix this is for the two of you to switch places. Then what we're going to do is we're going to set up a separate key for each subject. The key for the darker-skinned subject has to be carefully controlled so as not to overexpose the lighter-skinned subject. Now you can either do this with the barn doors on the light
Or better yet, you can do it with a carefully positioned flag like this one. This sort of flag is often called a gobo, and it can be used to more carefully control light on the set. Because it's further away from the light, it will cast a sharper edge shadow exactly where you want it. You'll also hear them called cutters. An overhead flag might be called a teaser from earlier theatrical terminology, or you might hear the terms sider, topper, or bottomer, depending on where they're positioned. We'll spend more time exploring the use of cutters in our next program. The effect is subtle, but now both subjects are well defined. You can get about the same effect with a single key light by using a scrim, which I mentioned earlier is a framed piece of black silk, screen, or organza, which cuts down on the light level in a specific area. Let's try that. The scrim reduces the light only on the lighter skinned subject. Take a look at how this works.
Can I put my glasses back on now?
Sure. As a matter of fact, that's good because that takes us right to the next problem we have to solve, reflections on glasses. Since you don't wear any, you're off the hook. Thanks, Danielle.
Okay, I'll see you later.
Bye. There are three basic approaches to solving this problem, and they often have to be used together. The first is to raise the light that's causing the reflection, which is usually the key. The second is to get the subject to tilt his or her head a little downward. In an interview situation, you may have to do this by having the interviewer sit in a slightly lower position. The third is to actually tilt the glasses on the subject's face a little bit by lifting the temple pieces up off the ears. Since all these approaches produce a fairly subtle change, it's not unusual to have to use all three together to reduce a really stubborn reflection.
The term gobo, a black flat or flag used to cast a shadow on the set, probably derives from the order to go black out. In early film production notes, this came to be abbreviated as GOBO or gobo.
Let's take a look at a few of the specific problems you're going to run into in the field. This banquet hall is a great illustration because it has a number of problems that you'll see frequently. It's set up for a dinner and a speaker tonight, and you have to videotape it, but the lighting is perfectly dreadful. Before we look at the specifics, though, let's go over some general points that you need to remember when you're working in the field. The first thing to bear in mind is the electrical load of your lights. Of course, you have to bear this in mind in any situation, but it's even more important when you're shooting in someone else's space. It's not considered good form to blow a bunch of breakers in a public event, and it won't do much good for your video either. When shooting in a new location, be sure to find out what kind of power you have available. Usually the janitor or building maintenance person will know. Older buildings sometimes have many outlets on a single breaker, and it's easy to blow the circuit. We'll explain more about this in our advanced lighting tape. But a good rule of thumb to bear in mind is that a 1,000-watt light will pull about 10 amps, and it's rare to find a breaker that will run more than 20 amps. You really need to spread your lights over several branch circuits, and that's a good idea in almost any situation. Always ask detailed questions about the program. If there's a refrigerator running somewhere, or the presenter is going to use an overhead projector, and it's plugged into the same branch circuit as your 1K Fresnel and 650-watt Omni, you've created a disaster waiting to happen. The breaker will blow right at the critical moment of the presentation, and you will shoulder the blame. But you also need to consider the impact your lights are going to have on video projectors, overheads, slides. If your lights ruin the presentation, you won't be a popular person. Here's where a few other items from our Gaffer's Survival Kit are essential. The first are miles and miles and miles of extension cords. You'll often hear these referred to as stingers. It's important to get a heavy gauge cable. Look for 12 gauge. Not as essential, but really handy, are a set of dimmers for your lights. Now, as I mentioned earlier, dimmers are not always ideal, because they'll change the color temperature of your lights towards orange as the voltage is reduced. So make sure that you white balance your camera with the dimmer set at the level you're actually going to use during the shoot. Now let's take a look at a few of the problems we need to fix in this room. Like many large public rooms, the lighting in here comes directly from above, great for illuminating the floor or tabletops, but it casts horrific shadows on people's faces. Plus, you'll get hot spots if there's someone with a white shirt or a gloriously shiny bald head right below a fixture. Lousy lighting and a touchy situation. Remember, a public event like this is a very different thing from a professional video shoot on a set where you have control over everything. In a situation like this, the live audience's experience is paramount. Your video shoot is really a secondary factor. But despite that, you'll get blamed for bad lighting and a poor end product. So it's really up to you to find a workable and unintrusive solution in advance. This is true for concerts and speeches, but it's even more true for religious ceremonies. Check with the client to find out house rules for lights and camera position in advance. Explain carefully and patiently why you may need to bring in extra lighting and why you need some control over the room lighting. Be unintrusive at the event. The best compliment that an event videographer can receive is, "We hardly knew you were there." When you have to illuminate a large area for shooting like this one, the Lowell Totalight, which we looked at earlier, is a pretty good solution. Now, you could just take the Totalight and aim it at the crowd and turn it on, but that's not really very merciful. Let me show you what it's like to be on the receiving end of that. Pow! Not too pleasant, is it? A better solution is to bounce the Totalight off the ceiling. This gives you a nice, general, soft illumination without blinding anybody.
Welcome, Professor Fernel Kukalaris.
Thank you. It's such a privilege to be here.
Take a look at the classic problems here. The overhead fixture causes a hot spot on the speaker's head and ugly shadows on his face. The podium light, although aimed at his speech notes, illuminates his white shirt as well. No amount of playing with your camera's iris will fix the basic problems of this shot, and you'll run into this sort of problem in many situations, including weddings and bar mitzvahs. My favorite solution for a problem like this is a fixture we haven't seen yet, a par can. Now, while a good Fresnel will work in this size of room, for many situations I recommend a par can with a long throw bulb. This is the solution that we use in churches and auditoriums and big halls where we have to throw light long distances. PAR stands for Parabolic Aluminized Reflector. PAR bulbs are completely self-contained with reflector and lens molded together. The type of bulb you buy determines the shape and throw and focus of the light beam. These are fairly inexpensive to buy. Mount this at the back of the room. Here's where one of those dimmers from the Gaffer's Survival Kit will come in really handy, because during a live event, there's just nothing more intrusive than a 1,000-watt light snapping on and off during a speech or a religious ceremony. A good dimmer will let you bring the light up smoothly at the appropriate time, as is done in the theater. If you're running the light at less than full power, be sure to mark the dimmer dial to the proper level. Remember, that's the level you've white balanced with, so you need to find it again accurately.
Welcome, Professor Fresnel Kukalaris.
The PAR can from the rear can illuminate the entire front area or just the podium, depending on the bulb you use.
When last I appeared before this...
If you videotape public events often, it's a good idea to have a number of different PAR bulbs on hand at all times to meet the demands of different situations. The principles of lighting that we've covered in this program should help you to light almost any situation to create good video. To recap, the essential issues have to do with controlling contrast and controlling color temperature. If you'll start off with that basic three-point lighting setup that we discussed earlier, with a key, a fill, and a backlight, and then improvise as necessary, you'll do pretty well. Be sure to check the results on a color monitor to catch any hidden problems. Take a little extra time in setup. It'll save you a lot of agony in post later.